over to the other side. Those are the plastic ones. Anybody have anything else? What? Pneumonia, it might depend on what kind of pneumonia, but what? Bronchitis, where the bronchioles are inflamed. The bronchioles are inflamed, the bronchi are inflamed, possibly the trachea. And so you've got an increased resistance because of the inflammation, et cetera, in those bronchioles, the bronchi.
Cancer.
What?
Cancer.
Cancer certainly could be. Depending exactly on what's happening. But, I mean, there are various types of lung cancer, et cetera. So some of them might decrease the capacity to a great degree, others to a minor degree. Okay, people misinterpreted this question. And so I didn't really count it that much. Physiological, physical consequences of the following. You have a reduced TV. I'm not asking you to tell me what TV means tidal volume. You have a reduced TV. Most of you had TVs around 400 or 500, something like that. But suppose I had a TV of 50. That means at rest, I'm moving 50 mLs of air in and out of my lung. What's the consequence of that? What?
Eventually,
your tissues,
your organs will supply the oxygen,
not putting enough energy back. Okay, so what's the consequence of that? Okay, this is why I think people were misinterpreting this. If I have a TV of 50, I can't walk down this hall. I'm probably in a wheelchair. That's a late stage emphysemic person. I get the idea that it's going to affect activity, and of course, reduced oxygen into the blood, et cetera, because you're not moving much air. Reduced ERV. You cannot expel amount of air over and above what you should be able to. What can I do? Yeah.
Exercise.
Can't exercise. I can't blow up a balloon. I can't blow out birthday candles. Right? Have I got the idea there? If you have very little expiratory reserve, so what? Well, can't blow up balloons, you can't scream. You get the idea. People get confused, I'm not sure why. Consequence means what happens because of it. Either you can't or you can or whatever. In this case, it's reduced, so it's probably going to be a negative consequence. IRV, reduced IRV. Exercise is out of the question pretty much, right? And of course, vital capacity is the sum of those three. So it comes back to pretty much the exercise, physical activity, reduced gas transport across the lung membranes.
So I got it? This is basically, you can answer like a general question of all of these readings. You don't have to break them down one by one.
Well, that's, I wanted that. That's why I have comments. But I could see that people were misinterpreting this question somehow. This is the same question we've asked for a long time. So the idea is reduced activity, okay? But you can take them separately. Suppose you just have a reduced ERV. You might not have a reduced IRV. But if you had a reduced ERV, would you have a reduced vital capacity? Yes, because part of the vital capacity. So any answers you're putting here, corrections, somehow should be in margin or somehow that I know that there are corrections. How might the body compensate for reduction in tidal volume? Some people said breathe deeper. Now, why can't that be an answer? You have a reduction in tidal volume. But if you could breathe deeper, you wouldn't have a reduction in tidal volume, right? You would breathe faster. Because what you want is the amount per minute ultimately going into your lungs. So you would breathe faster. Now, you don't consciously do that. Your brain would make you breathe faster. Why do you think your brain would make you feel breathe faster? We haven't gotten into this in lecture yet. Because of the buildup of what? Because of the buildup of CO2. Will make your brain, cause you to breathe faster. Your brain senses that, etc., so forth, and makes you breathe faster. All right. Values for the various lung capacities. Would they have been the same had the subject been in the positions? All right. Remember we did this standing, as I remember. Right? Would it have been the same if I'm sitting? No. Why not? Because of the diaphragm cannot go down as far because of the abdominal organs. Right? That's simple. Standing versus sitting, you should see standing is greater than sitting. Everybody got the idea? Very simple thing, the diaphragm can't go down as far. Can't contract as much. And therefore, your ability to expand that cavity, et cetera, expand your lungs is reduced. How about lying on your back? Lying on your back is pretty much the same as standing because there's really not much resistance to the diaphragm going down. On your chest. The chest would be less than standing, of course, because what? To breathe, lying on your chest, you can hardly use the external intercostals because basically you're trying to raise yourself off that whenever you're lying on. So it would be reduced because you're mainly relying on the diaphragm. We used to go in this class some years ago, we went to the medical examiner's office in Washington. We usually on a Friday, and they would save a cadaver for us, somebody that died for whatever reason or et cetera. And one year we went and they had this 18-year-old girl that had, except she weighed over 300 pounds. So if we took her, just about your size, if she weighed 300, let's say 300 pounds, would she have problems breathing? Well, because of she had like, I think it was 18 inches of tissue on her chest. So her chest was not like this, it was like this. So obviously that's going to interfere with what? Expanding her chest. Now, she had a tremendous abdomen, all right? That's going to have a problem with expanding the diaphragm because of the pressure against it. So forth. So, in her case, lying on her back might not be much difference between standing, but her vital capacity and inspiratory reserve and all that would be greatly, greatly reduced. Once in a while on TV, there was one on last night about these extremely overweight people that weigh something like 700 to 800 pounds. It goes through the sequence of the special doctor and getting them on a diet and removing, basically sewing up their stomach to a great degree. They had one last night. I think the guy started up at 700 and some pounds. And he got down to, about 250 in that neighborhood. There was one on earlier in the week. This was in Australia, I think. where they had to use, the person hadn't been out of bed for years. It looked like a big blob.
That what?
I think so. And they had to get a, they had to tear the wall out and use a hydraulic lift to get him out of the bed and on the stretcher. He couldn't stand up, et cetera. And over the course of months and months and months, finally got his weight down to some reasonable contraction. That person obviously has a hard time breathing. The one last night at least could stand up. The size of, well, not the size of the person, but more so the weight of the person is going to affect. All right, clinical values of measuring respiratory capacity. Why do you do it? That really is what the question is asking. Not what do they equal, but why do you even do it? What?
Disorders.
Of course, to find some sort of disorders. At least a preliminary test as what might be wrong with this person. Or is there anything wrong with them?